the Spirit of our God, we go to fast and pray. With Christ into the wilderness, we join his paschal way. Rend not your garments, rend your hearts, turn back your lives to me. Thus says our kind and gracious God, whose reign is liberty.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, as we come together to celebrate these sacred mysteries, once again coming on technology over Bellevue Cable System and Facebook Live, hoping that everything is working as it should, let us pause to call to mind our failings so as to prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries.
Kyrie eleison. Christe eleison. Kyrie eleison.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. By your help, we beseech you, Lord our God, may we walk eagerly in that same charity with which, out of love for the world, your Son handed himself over to death. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, O my people, I will open your graves and have you rise from them and bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and have you rise from them, O my people, I will put my spirit in you that you may live, and I will settle you upon your land. Thus you shall know that I am the Lord. I have promised, and I will do it, says the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my voice in supplication. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. with you is forgiveness, and so you may be revealed. With the Lord there is mercy and fullness of redemption. Trust in the Lord, my soul trust in his word. My soul waits for the Lord more than sentinels wait for the dawn. With the Lord there is mercy.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, those who are in the flesh cannot please God, but you are not in the flesh. On the contrary, you are in the Spirit, if only the Spirit of God dwells in you. Whoever does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. If the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, the one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also, through his Spirit dwelling in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Whoever believes in me, even if he dies, will never die. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now a man was ill, Lazarus from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who had anointed the Lord with perfumed oil and dried his feet with her hair. It was her brother Lazarus who was ill. So the sister sent word to him saying,
Master, the one you love is ill.
When Jesus heard this, he said,
This illness is not to end in death, but is for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it.
Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister Lazarus, So when he heard that he was ill, he remained for 2 days in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to his disciples,
Let us go back to Judea.
The disciples said to him,
Rabbi, the Jews were just trying to stone you, and you want to go back there?
Jesus answered,
Are there not 12 hours in a day? If one walks during the day, he does not stumble because he sees the light of this world. But if one walks at night, he stumbles because the light is not in him.
He said this and then told them,
Our friend Lazarus is asleep, but I am going to awaken him.
So the disciples said to him,
Master, if he is asleep, he will be saved.
But Jesus was talking about his death, while they thought that he meant ordinary sleep. So then Jesus said to them clearly,
Lazarus has died, and I am glad for you that I was not there, that you may believe. Let us go to him.
So Thomas, called Didymus, said to his fellow disciples,
Let us also go to die with him.
When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, only about 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, but Mary sat at home. Martha said to Jesus,
Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you.
Jesus said to her,
Your brother will rise.
Martha said to him,
I know he will rise in the resurrection on the last day.
Then Jesus told her,
I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even if he dies, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?
She said to him,
Yes, Lord. I have come to believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who is coming into the world.
When she had said this, she went and called her sister Mary secretly, saying,
The teacher is here and is asking for you.
As soon as she heard this, she rose quickly and went to him. For Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still where Martha had met him. So when the Jews who were with her in the house, comforting her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out, they followed her, presuming that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said to him,
Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died.
When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come with her weeping, he became perturbed and deeply troubled and said,
Where have you laid him?
They said to him,
Sir, come and see.
And Jesus wept. So the Jews said,
See how he loved him.
But some of them said,
Could not the one who opened the eyes of the blind man have done something so that this man would not have died?
So Jesus, perturbed again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay across it. Jesus said,
Take away the stone.
Martha, the dead man's sister, said to him,
Lord, by now there will be a stench. He has been dead for 4 days.
Jesus said to her,
Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?
So they took away the stone, and Jesus raised his eyes and said,
Father, I thank you for hearing me. I know that you always hear me, but because of the crowd here, I have said this, that they may believe that you sent me.
And when he had said this, he cried out in a loud voice,
Lazarus, come out.
The dead man came out, tied hand and foot with burial bands, and his face was wrapped in a cloth. So Jesus said to them,
Untie him and let him go.
Now many of the Jews who had come to Mary and seen what he had done began to believe in him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Lord Jesus Christ. Friends, peace be with you. Many of you have experienced that somewhere between 4 months and 7 months, a child goes from only knowing what's in the world by seeing what's in front of them to knowing that it's there, whether it's present or not. They call this object permanence. It's what makes playing peekaboo so fun with somebody who is 4 to 7 months. But there's a point when they know that you're really there, even when they're covering their eyes, and it's more just the shock of somebody saying peekaboo that scares them. But before that, they're not 100% sure that you're still there. In those first few months, if you get annoyed by the sounds of an annoying toy, or if a child becomes fascinated by an electrical outlet with their fork,
All you have to do is remove the toy or cover over the outlet, remove it from the child's sight, and suddenly it's gone. Didn't exist in the first place. However, once object permanence is established, you risk a temper tantrum for removing the toy of temptation, especially if it was something that they were taking great pleasure in exploring, or if they're especially short on sleep and seem as though anything is going to cause a temper tantrum. St. John's story of the death and resuscitation of Lazarus is extremely vivid and full of details that are worth pondering and remembering. For instance, whereas St. Matthew, St. Mark, and St. Luke would have most likely simply started telling this story from the vantage point of when they arrived at Bethany, St. John starts 2 days in advance in the northern part of Israel, which is called the Galilee region. We know from other Gospels that Galilee was where Jesus did most of his ministry, and that Bethany was the place where he would stay instead of in Jerusalem itself when he either wanted to visit the temple or did ministry in the southern part of Israel called Judea. St. John starts this story up in the Galilee region when we hear that Lazarus, Jesus' friend, is sick. Jesus knows that the illness will end in death. In fact, before being told that he's dead, he says Lazarus is dead. So he waits 2 days. Now, it says that the people in the south were trying to kill him, so he wanted to wait for things to calm down. So he waits 2 days. St. Thomas then says, "Then let us all go and die with him." It seems a cynical remark, but in truth, what St. John is trying to provide for us is something that, in the light of when this gospel would have been read, would have sounded very different than at the time. A cynical remark by St. Thomas points to the fact that St. Thomas and the other apostles will, in fact, follow Jesus to death when they are martyred as his followers. See how subtle that is? It sounds like the cynical remark that all of us probably would have made if we would have been with Jesus at the time, and even kind of some of us maybe chuckle if we really get into the scripture itself. And yet, it points to the fact that they will follow Jesus to be martyred after Jesus goes there first, even before he's died. They're starting to point to their own faith and willingness to follow. Now, we're not exactly sure how long it took them to make the trip from Bethany or down to Bethany. It appears as though it took at least a couple of days. The next time frame that we're given is that Martha tells them that it had been 4 days since Lazarus had been in the tomb. In any case, Jesus arrives, and there's this parallel to the earlier story that we hear in the Gospel of Luke about Martha and Mary. You might remember this great gem of scripture where Martha is often seen as the more active, Mary is seen as the contemplative. Jesus says Mary has chosen the better part. The parallel is that Martha is the first to speak to Jesus, just like in that story. And yet there's also a bit of contrast as Martha goes running outside of the city to greet Jesus. What's interesting about this is that they would have buried the body of Lazarus outside of the city as well. So it appears as though Jesus may be kind of making a beeline for the tomb, and Martha intercepts him. Her statement to him is, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that whatever you ask of God will grant you." There's an element of faith and hope and love in that statement from Martha, which is very much absent. This is the contrast with that earlier experience, where it appears as though Martha is the one with faith here, running out to see Jesus, saying, "I know that you can do this. I know that God listens to you." Jesus says then, "I am," one of his famous "I am" statements from the Gospel of John, "I am the resurrection and the life." This phrase that we hear so often in Catholic funerals, "I am the resurrection and the life." He says, "Have you come to believe?" Martha is so excited, so hopeful, that she calls Mary. Mary brings along this group of professional mourners. At the time, there were people that would just go from funeral to funeral, hoping that maybe they could get in a meal or something like that, and able to just mourn with the people. That's why when she is crying, they're crying too. It'd be probably more crocodile tears than real tears. But nonetheless, Mary comes with all of these people. Now, what Mary says sounds very similar to Martha. Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. There's no but, however. There's no hope in Mary's statement. Unlike when she's sitting at the foot of Jesus, contemplating, at this point, her apathy comes through. She isn't sitting there contemplatively pondering the Lord. She's absent. She's watched her brother for 4 days in a tomb, dead, wondering, knowing that he cannot be resurrected. Jesus says to her, basically, have hope. Now, as good storytellers too, there's a third element when Martha once again approaches the Lord as he's ready to roll back the tomb. And even though she's evidenced faith, she says, Lord, there's going to be a stench. So it's that idea of, yeah, I believe, but help my unbelief, as another scripture passage says. I believe, but I don't want it to be tested. I don't want to have to prove that I actually trust that when we roll away the stone, that we're not going to smell elements of decay. This aggravates Jesus. He gets frustrated twice in this gospel. And yet, we shouldn't forget the fact that Jesus cried. Jesus wept as a part of this. Wept for his friend Lazarus for having to face death in the first place. Wept because of the inept faith on the part of all the believers, or the complete lack of faith. Jesus wept. It's the only time in Scripture that it says this. Still, he says, Lazarus, come out. And Lazarus comes out. Unlike Jesus, who will appear, his burial cloths will still be in the tomb. It's almost like the burial cloths of Lazarus mark the fact that this isn't really a resurrection, but a resuscitation. He has come back to life, but Lazarus will die. He will die after this. Now, this is definitely seen as a sign by the gospel writer of what is to come later, but I like these little details that he includes to say that the body is still wrapped. And yet people come to faith because of the resuscitation of Lazarus. Death is a confusing thing, and certainly in this time of COVID-19, as we are trying to figure out how our life is going to work in this death experience, certainly feeling like we almost can't even leave our house can almost feel like a small death. I think it's not the worst thing in the world to contemplate the fact that we are, in fact, all going to go this way. Not by our own volition or choice, but whenever God wants it to take place. And there are two things that kind of jumped to the fore for me. The first is when we have to be with somebody who is sick and who is probably headed more toward their death, and we call upon the Lord to say, Lord, if you had been here, if you are here, my brother should not die. Jesus waited 2 days. It was because he knew, as it said, we would see the glory of God for what had happened. Resuscitation is great, but resurrection is better. Resuscitation ends. Lazarus had to die. Jesus rose from the dead and never dies again. It gives us hope to be able to see through this most evil of all things that is death, to be able to see that life in the spirit, as it said in the first reading and the second reading for today, is so much better than life in the flesh. It gives us hope for something better. The other thing is that when the world comes to us and tries to sell us on the cheap things of this world, we have a much better life in heaven. And that's where that object permanence thing comes back for me. Jesus has revealed through his death and resurrection, through the cross and through the empty tomb, that he has risen from the dead. When we look around the world, we're tempted to believe that everything comes into life and passes away. But in Jesus Christ, we can see that the hope of believers, the life in the Spirit, is for fullness of life in resurrection. Can we see that object permanence in Jesus? Or do we get too busy looking at things that are passing away and lose faith in the one who can save us from death and use death to give us eternal life along with him, just as he has given it through himself?
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
And I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Trusting in the life-giving power of the Spirit, we lift our prayers and petitions to our Father in heaven.
That all leaders and members of the church may be graced with the guidance and wisdom of the Holy Spirit, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. That world leaders may be helped by God in putting aside selfish agendas and seek justice and equality for the people under their care, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who are in mourning may be consoled by God in their grief and made confident in the hope of resurrection for their loved ones, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. That all the members of this faith community may receive the mercy of God for themselves and with his help offer it to others. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For the living members of the Rosary Society and our beloved dead, especially Darlene Manders, Nico Sietlow, Maynard Meyer, Janet Steinis, and all those who have died. May they know the joy and the fullness of life in heaven. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for those special intentions we hold within our hearts. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
Merciful Father, with humble confidence, we ask you to hear these prayers through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You may have all this world, give me Jesus. Now the journey has begun, now the journey has begun, now the journey has begun. Give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You may have all this world, give me Jesus. When the prize is surely won, when the prize is surely won, when the prize is surely won, give me Jesus, give me Jesus.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Hear us, Almighty God, and having instilled in your servants the teachings of the Christian faith, graciously purify them by the working of this sacrament, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as true man he wept for Lazarus his friend, and as Eternal God raised him from the tomb. Just as taking pity on the human race, he leads us by sacred mysteries to new life. Through him the host of angels adores your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna.
Therefore, Almighty Father, we bless through Jesus Christ, your Son, who comes in your name. He himself is the word that brings salvation, the hand you extend to sinners, the way by which your peace is offered to us. When we ourselves had turned away from you on account of our sins, you brought us back to be reconciled, O Lord, so that converted at last to you, we might love one another through your Son, whom for our sake you handed over to death. And now, celebrating the reconciliation Christ has brought us, we entreat you, sanctify these gifts by the outpouring of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, whose command we fulfill when we celebrate these mysteries. For when about to give his life to set us free, as he reclined at supper, he himself took bread into his hands. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, on that same evening, he took the chalice of blessing in his hands, confessing your mercy, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Celebrating, therefore, the memorial of the death and resurrection of your Son, who left us this pledge of his love, we offer you what you have bestowed on us, the sacrifice of perfect reconciliation. Holy Father, we humbly beseech you to accept us also together with your Son, and in this saving banquet, graciously to endow us with his very Spirit, who takes away everything that estranges us from one another. May he make your church a sign of unity and an instrument of your peace among all people, and may he keep us in communion with Francis, our Pope, and Michael, our Bishop, and all the bishops and your entire people. Just as you have gathered us now at the table of your Son, so also bring us together with the glorious Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and all the saints, with our brothers and sisters and those of every race and tongue who have died in your friendship. Bring us to share with them the unending banquet of unity in a new heaven and a new earth, where the fullness of your peace will shine forth in Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit, let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
May the body of Christ keep you safe for eternal life.
You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your words in foreign lands, and all will understand. You shall see the face of God and live. Be not afraid. I go before you always. Come, follow me, and I will give you rest.
An act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite my whole self wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Let us pray. We pray, Almighty God, that we may always be counted among the members of Christ, in whose body and blood we have communion, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Been request to let people know the next time we will be recording, which is at 10:15 tomorrow on Sunday. We will have basically the repeat, although Deacon Loris and Carolyn will be here instead of Deacon Robert and Sarah. We're glad that you could be here tonight, however. But you'll hear the same homily, so if you want to be bored all over again, come back at 10:15 tomorrow. After that, I take Mondays as a day off and then start at 8:25 on Tuesday morning, along with 3 o'clock on Tuesday, and then 8:25 throughout the rest of the week. So you're certainly welcome to join us for any of those masses or rosaries, and hopefully you'll be there. So really the next Sunday Mass is again tomorrow at 10:15, but the next daily Mass will be Tuesday at 8:25, just like normal. At this point, we're still able to, as carefully as possible, bring individual communion to people. So if you want to receive communion, especially if you're sick, please don't hesitate to call the rectory. I anticipate, just like 2 weeks ago, I anticipated that this was going to happen. I anticipate this week will be the time when the governor has to say basically no contact whatsoever and a lockdown. Now, I've been wrong before. I'm no Nostradamus or Ezekiel the prophet, but the signs are all pointing that this is going to get worse in the not so distant future, this week and next week. So we'll do our best, but right now I'm basically prohibited from anointing people. Even confession is strongly discouraged, and getting communion may be difficult too. That's why we read that prayer. Found out that's from St. Alphonsus Liguori, that prayer for spiritual communion, since so many of us are, in fact, distanced from communion, and that this is the best way we can do it until this passes. That's why we pray that. So that's basically all the announcements. Although, just like last week, we will have bulletins available both at Saints Peter and Paul and at St. Joe's by the door, and it's also online, and I encourage you, please, to take a look at the bulletin for the Archbishop's announcements about what's happened so far, and just to keep plugged in with your parish and what's happening. Okay. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thanks be to God.
The glory of these 40 days we celebrate with songs of praise. For Christ, by whom all things were made, himself has fasted and has prayed. O Father, Son, and Spirit blessed, to you.